Good morning and welcome to Trinity Alliance Church. We're so glad that the Lord has led you here to worship with us today. Whether you're joining us here in person or you're watching online, just want to encourage you to take a moment. Even if you're at home, silence your cell phone, put it aside. Take a deep breath and just lay down the distractions. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. That was half-hearted. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. Come on, guys. We're better than that. More importantly, our God is better than that. So we've come to worship Him, and we've come to bless His name. And as we prepare, I just want to take a moment. The guitar's going to play. Just breathe out all the distractions and breathe in the spirit of a loving God who looked at you before you were born and said, "That one's mine. And I love her." I truly believe that's what He does with us. Before we're even born, He chose you. What an amazing concept. It's so far beyond what we can even imagine. Just bask in the love of your Father today. Able to stand as we read the call to worship. If you're unable, please don't stress about it. Just hear my words. As we read the Word of God, I'm reading from Psalm 29 today, and I would encourage you to really dig deeper on your own. The Lord says so many things to us through His Word. Psalm 29 begins like this: "Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon leap like a calf. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forest bare. And in His temple all cry, 'Glory!' The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as King forever. The Lord gives strength to His people. The Lord blesses His people with peace." As we worship Him this morning, I really, I just feel an overwhelming sense to just encourage you to worship from where you are. You know, we don't serve a God that waits for you to check a box off. "Oh, she came to church. It's good." He says, "That one's mine and she's wandering, so let me go find her and bring her back." That's how much He loves us. I'm so humbled. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, please let me tell you. He wants to love you, but it requires your acceptance. And for those of us who have accepted Him, and who know what that love feels like, sometimes we take it for granted, don't we? "I know He'll catch me. It's okay." What an amazing task. And what a powerful God. We're a lot of people in this little building in the middle of nowhere in Galloway. There are people all over the world worshiping him today. And we get the privilege of worshiping at the same time. It's overwhelming, isn't it? How big is your God? It's not a sermon. It's simply meant as an encouragement. There are times in my life when God is small, and there are times when he is all, and I mean there is nothing else. When that consuming time comes, what you have inside of you is what comes out. So my friends, I caution you, make sure that it's him that's inside of you. It's just meant as an encouragement. As we worship God with some old-fashioned hymns, that bring back my childhood and might bring back some memories for others. The words, whether old or new, are good because they focus our hearts on the Lord. Amen? That's the language of worship. Anything that focuses your heart on him. Let's worship him together. Above all human flesh, that you would hide us behind the cross and that we would see your face in this place today. Reveal your heart to your children, Lord. Remind us how big and powerful you are, all the while loving us like no other. Thank you. Still be my vision, O ruler of all. It should be all of our prayers this morning. Just gonna ask the guitar to play. Just let it rest over you. Feel the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place and let him in. Sing verse 1 again with us. Spirit, we do not have to face this world alone. the light that shines to draw us to you can now shine within us to draw others to you. So God, use us. And teach us, God, to lift our eyes above our situation, above ourselves, above our offenses, above what we lack, above what we think we already have mastered. All of that, God, we lay down. Lord, lift our eyes. Be my vision, Lord. If I cannot see you, then let me not see this world. And Lord, I pray that as you teach us to look up to you, that you teach us to look at others in this world as you looked at us. Give us your eyes, Father. Give us your love and compassion. Let us communicate with urgency the gift of salvation, God. We love you, Lord. And we want to worship you. But we get in our own way sometimes, Lord. So I pray that you teach us one step at a time how much of a light your presence really is. Teach us to depend on you, because you alone are trustworthy, God. We love you, Lord. We give you all of our praise today. In Jesus' holy and precious name, all God's people said, amen. You may be seated.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day to freely worship you. We thank you for all the gifts that you bestow upon us, Lord, so freely. Will you accept our worship, a worship that you ask us to give back a portion of all that you've given us, Lord? We ask that you bless it to help further your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Several announcements today, as you should already know, but if you're new here, we are present on Facebook and Instagram. Facebook, it's tachurch.com. It's the Facebook prayer group also. Trinity Alliance Church on Instagram, we are TA Church. We're bringing back some old fun times. It's Pine Car Derby time. I don't know. I'm like a nine generation Christian church girl, so Pine Car Derbies are probably in my DNA somewhere, so I don't know, it's just something we do. But we're bringing it back because it's fun, and who doesn't want some fun together with the family? So this coming Saturday, they'll be meeting three Saturdays in a row starting February 17th at 9 a.m. here. You do need to sign up so that we have enough materials for you to build your car. And by family time, this can be you joining the family of God, so you can come alone. It can be you bringing your whole family, or it can just be a little part of your family. It makes no difference because we're all family. So is that too confusing to follow? Pine Car Derby, if you want to come, come, please. You qualify. So it's going to be a good time, but we do need you to sign up. March 2nd is race day. For those of you who will not be participating in the building and the racing, there will be a spectator section. So, you know, there may or may not be loud cheering happening. We're not sure. But when Pastor Jeff's involved, you're just never sure how excitable it'll be. But this Wednesday, February 14th, it's that Hallmark holiday, guys. The youth group will be offering free babysitting from 6:30 to 8:30. And I've been on both sides of that. So I'm going to tell you, if you have children, partake in this ministry. And also, if you have children, don't forget to pick them up at 8:30. Because I've also been the one watching the children. And when 8:30 becomes 9, it's a little less easy to do it next year. So 6:30 to 8:30. But please sign your kids up and we'll have a good time with them. The Mason Jar Ministry is asking specifically for gluten-free cracker donations. I'm new to the gluten-free world. My daughters have developed issues later in life, so I'm learning. But there's a whole section in the grocery stores now. So just go in that section, pick out some crackers that the boxes look nice, and bring them for the Mason Jar Ministry, and they'll be very grateful. If you have any questions, just check the back. If it includes wheat, it's not gluten-free, okay? And gluten, yes. You have to read on there. It can have no wheat and still have gluten. So if it doesn't say gluten-free, please don't. Or you'll be taking it back home. It won't be helpful. So anyway, sorry for the specifics, but that's what we need. And at this time, Miss Sheila is going to come up and excite us with her refit announcements.
Good morning, everyone. I've been asked to make an announcement this morning, but before I do that, I have a question for you. Here we are, second weekend of February. How are your New Year's resolutions going? Everybody just kind of giggles, right? So I have a little bit of a challenge for you this morning, where I want you to think of fitness as a different aspect. Think of it as stewardship. A lot of times we give our money, and we think of money as being a good steward of what God has given of us. But it also includes our talents. It includes our relationships. It includes our time. And it includes our bodies. 1 Corinthians in chapter 6, verse 9, it says, "Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You are bought with a price. Therefore, honor your God with your body." So when we sit on the couch and we do nothing, a good friend of mine says, motion is lotion. So God intended for our bodies to move. And here, Tuesday night, ladies, this is for you. Every Tuesday night, we have a refit class. A while back, God said to me, "Sheila, you're going to teach a fitness class." And I'm like, "Yeah, Lord, right." How can I do that? And here we are 12 years later. And this class has been going on every Tuesday night. So if you didn't know about it, now you know about it. If you tried it, you love it. but it's for anybody with any fitness ability, young, old, doesn't matter. It's fun movements to uplifting music, and it's Tuesday nights at 7 o'clock, and ladies, I hope you come out. Thank you so much.
Hello. It's coming up on Valentine's Day, so men get ready. myself included, I'm terrible. So I'll just say happy Valentine's Day to everyone. We want to love one another. In 1 Corinthians, verse 10. It said, "I beg you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree with one another and not be split into groups. I beg that you be completely joined together by having the same kind of thinking that the same possess." There's so much division in the world. You know, we can find all kinds of things to disagree about, and that's not a hard thing to do. But we're compelled as Christians to love one another, and meet each other on a common ground. You know, knowing Jesus Christ, knowing the Word, loving one another. And what we need to do sometimes is that we need to do that in our lives, out in the world, which is very hard to do, and we need to do it in our homes, with our spouses, with our loved ones. And sometimes that's harder than being out in the world. You know, the occasional relationship is easier to cultivate than the one that we have at home. We can really tear each other apart sometimes. So in this season, I ask that we employ that love of Jesus Christ, not only out in the world, but also at home, you know, with that special person. My special person isn't here today. She didn't want to cough on anyone, so she says, I'm going to stay home. She loved you that much. let me just pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just ask that you give us all an extra measure of strength and the ability to be forgiving, loving, and finding that joy and peace that comes with just loving one another in the way that Jesus intended. You sent your son here, and what a gift that is for us, Lord. We just need to realize that Jesus died for our sins. And one of those sins is just not being totally connected, not being one with our brothers in Christ. So help us to explore that in a more faithful way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. All right, we are going to be in Exodus chapter 32. Exodus chapter 32 this morning. Open up my Bible here. Got to get all my stuff situated when I get up here. All right, we're continuing on in the Old Testament, doing the survey that we have been going through. And as I was reading some stuff throughout this week, I came across an article that I was looking at and reading, and it was about a German painter named Adolf Menzel. All right, and he has a bunch of different paintings out, but he has one of his paintings is in the art gallery there in Berlin. All right, and it's only partially done. See, the idea he had was to paint Frederick the Great speaking with his generals and some of the commanders that he had under him. And so as he painted all the generals and he painted all those people that were there, and he painted the background, and he had the majority of all the figures done except for Frederick the Great, which he saved for last, right? And he kind of had them charcoaled in there a little bit, all right, getting ready to, but he ended up dying before he ever got a chance to finish it. All right, and as I'm looking at that, I'm thinking as I read that, a lot of us as Christians, we come to the end of our lives, right, and we never had put Christ in the place that he should have been in. Our painting is left unfinished. We have the idea to put Christ there, and part of our life is to have Christ in the center, and he's going to be the main focus of our lives. But we have all these other things in our lives that we put in there, and we make sure everything is set around us. But actual God himself, the main figure of our painting of our lives, never gets complete. He's never finished. We kind of have him charcoaled into our life, but we never fully adapt to him and never fully put him in the place that he needs to be. All right? And looking at Exodus chapter 32, I'm just going to read the first six verses. We're going to kind of skip around the whole chapter today, but I'm just going to read the first six verses here. Exodus 32, verses 1 through 6. Now when the people saw that Moses delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aaron and said to him, "Come, make us gods that shall go before us. And for as for this Moses, the man who brought us out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him." And Aaron said to them, "Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me." So all the people broke off their golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hands and fashioned it with an engraving tool and made a molded calf. Then they said, "This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt." So when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it. And Aaron made a proclamation and said, "Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord." Then they rose early on the next day, offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat, drink, and rose up to play. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we ask for a blessing upon the reading of your word this morning. Lord, we ask that you just be here within this service, Lord. Allow your words to be spoken this morning. Allow hearts to receive and ears to be open to hear that which you have for us today. In your name, amen. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. All right, we sang that this morning, and we as a people, we tend to do that. We wander away from what God has for us and what he has done, and we go to build our own idols. We go to serve our own self and do what that is that we want to do, even though we know that the Lord is there and he's supposed to be the center. We kind of move away from that. All right? And this morning, I want to look at three main points that I get out of this chapter. We're going to look at desire, decision, and direction. All right? Desire, decision, and direction. So the first thing we're going to look at is desire. All right? And we as a people have a desire to worship. We were created to worship. All right? That's how God made us. That's how we were built. We are going to worship something. And you see that even in verse 1 in chapter 32, which I just read. The people had a desire. They said, "Come, make us gods that shall go before us." They want to be led. They want to worship something, to be led by something, to have something there that they can physically hold on to and see, feel, and touch and be able to move on in that way. And that's the desire in their heart. And each and every one of us have that desire. The Hebrew word for worship is shakah. All right? And that means to bow down to something that is superior. That is what we're going to worship. And we as a people, that is what we are going to do. Be it the idols that we make, be it God, whatever we have, we are going to bow down and we are going to be in submission to that authority. We are going to be in submission to that which we feel is superior. And no matter what we have within our lives, if we put it before God, we have made that superior in our lives, and that is what we then worship. Okay, that is what's taken the place. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, all right, tells us that we have eternity in our hearts, that the Lord has placed eternity in our hearts. He has put within us the desire to worship, the desire to seek something that is greater than ourselves. All right? We don't just settle for the fact that we're here, right? And that's it. There's always something that we're trying to attain, something that we're trying to grasp for, something that we're trying to look for, something that we're going to go after. That is our human nature. We're not just going to sit around and just be like, it is what it is and there is nothing more. Even those that don't believe in God know that something had to have created this world. There is something that is greater than ourselves. All right, believe in God, don't believe in God. Whatever the belief is, whatever your feeling is, there is that within us that says, it is not just me, there is something greater than me. And the Lord put that there within us to grasp for, to want to worship, to want to desire, to seek that which is greater. All right, and that's what we're going to go after. It's part of us. It's ingrained with us, and that's what he is saying there. And everyone worships a God of some kind. Yes? All right? Whatever it's going to be, you say, I don't worship anything. I don't have any type of, you know, idol in front of me. Doesn't have to be something of that physical nature, right? Whether we worship money, time, whatever it is, there is something that we worship. Ourselves, it's something, right? We don't just go day by day and do nothing. There's always something that we are going after that we want to obtain, achieve, or say, this is what is going to drive me. This is what is going to consume me. This is what I use my time for. That in itself becomes the idol, that which consumes you. All right? And something's going to fill that space. We are going to find something to fill us. Isn't that what the world is after? Don't you see that with, you look at the world and everything that's going on, people are looking for something to fill them, right? They want something to come in and fill that hole, that emptiness that they feel within their lives. They want it filled, and they're going to find something, no matter what it is, as long as it makes them happy, as long as it can make them for that 1 second even, feel like they are complete. Feel like they have it within them, that this is what I need to be happy. This is what I need to complete my life. That's what they're going to go after. And that eternity that's within our hearts, that which the Lord had placed in us, we're going to seek after that, and we are going to find something to fill that void that we have within us. And we are going to worship it, and we are going to allow that to consume us. And that is going to become our idol. Now, we want that to be the Lord, right? We as believers that know Christ, that have come to Christ, we know that that which fills us is going to be Christ. That is who we are going to worship. He is the one who is able to come in and make our lives complete and not have that emptiness within us, right? But the world, those that don't have Christ within them, they are going to just seek whatever they can grasp onto, whatever for that one moment is going to make them feel good, and they're going to use that to fill that void, and that becomes very dangerous, right, in there. And we have what I call a ready-mix God, right? Ready-mix God, and that's kind of what I entitled the message today is ready-mix God. You know, when I used to enjoy cooking, I love breakfast, so when I make pancakes, I would always make them with flour, eggs, oil. I'd put it all together. And it wasn't until later that I discovered that they had ready mix. You just add water and there it is. You don't have to go through all the work and everything that it takes to make pancakes. You know, put all this stuff together. It's just here it is, add it. And that's what we as a people, we have our ready mix gods. We're going to have it there to where we can just put it together and there is God. But the fact is, worship of the true God is going to take time and effort. It's going to take time and effort because it's a relationship. Relationships take time and effort, do they not? You've got to put something in to get something out. You're not going to have a relationship with someone if you don't go and talk to them. You're not going to have a relationship with someone if you don't listen to them. You got to put forth the effort. You can't just blow it off and say, you know, I'm not going to talk to this person. I want to be this person's friend, or I want to have a relationship with this person, but I'm not going to bother, you know, even sending them a text every now and then or calling them or talking to them and just let it be. You're not going to have a true, strong relationship. It's not going to be there, all right? And that's what, when we worship God, we're going to have to put that time and effort in. But we as a people, we don't want to do that. We don't have the time to put in, so we think, or so we say. And we don't want to put that effort in because we're too tired. We have, you know, this going on or that going on, and it keeps getting pushed by the wayside, and that painting of our lives that is there, just a little charcoal is going on the print, but we're never putting God in the center in the main place where he's supposed to be. And it becomes very dangerous when we start to do that. 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. And as always, I try to give you a bunch of references to always revert back to. Don't always have time to go to every one of them. But please do write them down if you do not turn there. 2 Timothy 4, verses 3 and 4 says, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables." Ready mix gods. They're not going to endure the truth. They're not going to hear the truth because that's going to take too much time, and they don't want to hear what the truth is. The fact that they are sinners heading to hell if they do not grasp on to who God is and take him as Lord and Savior. They don't want to hear the fact that that which the world calls right, God calls sin. They don't want to deal with that because they're saying if it's right in their own eyes, that's what they are going to do, for it's right for them. Okay? And so what they're going to do is, because they don't want to hear that, according to their own desires, according to everything that they want, they're going to take all that, they're going to throw it in the pot, and out is going to pop a God that fits their needs, that fits what they want to have, that fits their desire. My God says this is okay. My God says I can do this. My God says everything that is part of me that I want to do is fine. You go ahead and do it. You can have it your way right away because you're number one. We'd redefine God to fit our own desires. And back to Exodus chapter 32, when you look at verse 24, it says, "And I said to them," this is Aaron speaking to Moses, "and I said to them, whoever has any gold, let them break it off. So they gave it to me, and I cast it into the fire, and this calf came out." Right? So they came to Aaron, and they said, "Look, we don't know what happened to this man, Moses. Moses who led them out of Israel, Moses who had them cross the Red Sea, Moses who prayed to God and manna fell for them to eat, Moses who struck a rock and water came out for them to drink, Moses who went to Pharaoh and talked to him to have the release of Israel go. Now they're saying, this man, Moses." It's not very affectionate. They pretty much have already done away with him. All that he's led them through, all that he has been to them, they say, "This man, Moses, we don't know what happened to him. He went up on the mountain. He hasn't come back. So look, this is what we want you to do, Aaron. We want you to make us a God to go before us, because the one that we've been looking at for the past few months is gone, and we don't know anything about it." So Aaron says, "Fine, give me all your gold, give me the earrings and everything you have." And it says, right, we read it, that with a fashioning tool that he made this calf, this idol. But now he tells Moses, when Moses comes down and says, "What in the world are you doing? I've been talking to God. I come down. You guys are out of control. You're worshiping this calf. What in the world goes on?" He tells Moses, "Well, you know what? I was just kind of playing with the fire, just throwing some stuff in there. And just like the phoenix, out of the ashes come this calf." Are you kidding me? Complete lie to what he has, to what Moses was asking him. He says it just popped out, but that's what we do. We throw all of our stuff into our fire that we have within our lives. We throw our happiness. We throw any hobbies that we have. We throw our money, our success, everything that we have, we're going to throw into this fire of life. And all of a sudden, with our ready mix that we have, out pops this God that we're going to worship. When we know who the true God is and the one that has been leading us through our lives, we're well aware that he is the one. We have heard from him. We have seen him work. We have known the God of Israel. We have known the God of our salvation. And yet we are going to take our ready mix, throw it into the fire, and have our God that we're going to worship pop out because it's going to fit our desires, our needs, and our wants. And that's exactly what happened here. And it leads to destruction. Matthew 7:13 says, wide, easy is the road that leads to destruction. See, the narrow road, that's the hard one. And that's why I said it takes time and effort. And that narrow road, which is going to lead to salvation, lead to the Lord Jesus Christ, that's a road paved with struggle. That's a road paved with sorrow. That's a road paved with tribulation. It's there somewhere. It's a road that's not easy to go on, but that's going to lead to Christ. But wide is the road, and that's the road that most everybody takes. It's going to be that easy road. It's the road paved with my own happiness, the road paved with my own desires, the road paved with anything that I want to do to get to where I want to get. That's going to be the God I serve. And the Bible says it's going to lead to destruction. It's a very dangerous road to follow. The tabernacle was the true pattern of worship, right? We talked about the tabernacle last time I spoke, right? That is the true pattern of worship. That is what we follow. That is what we lead. And God knew that the people wanted to worship. God knew that the people needed it. He put it within their heart. And he's up talking to Moses, laying the footwork of the tabernacle. He's telling Moses, this is how it's going to be. I am laying out for you direction by step by step by step as to how the true worship is to take place. And as God is up there talking to Moses, laying this footwork for what he knows the people want, the people are down there already saying, God isn't here, make my own God. Give me what I want right now. We don't wait upon the Lord. And that's what Isaiah 40 verse 31 says. Wait upon the Lord. Those that wait upon the Lord, their strength is going to be renewed. But we don't want to wait. We don't want to see what the Lord has. We want it now. That's how we want it. I don't want to wait to see our true worship, Lord. I don't want to wait to see what you're going to do. I want my desire and I want it now. And that's what the people did. The Lord knew exactly what they needed. The Lord knew exactly what they wanted. And he was going to give it to them. He was laying the footwork at the same time. But the people didn't wait. They didn't want to wait on the Lord. They didn't want to wait for his answer. They didn't want to wait for his plan. They had a desire, and they were looking to fill it. And they did it their way instead of God's way. Secondly, we're going to look at decision. Right? The decision. Because when we have a desire, we are going to make a decision. Right? Choose you this day whom you will serve. That's going to be the decision. Choose who you are going to serve. You see that in Joshua 24:15, right? That's what Joshua said to the people. Choose you this day whom you are going to serve. As for me and my house, we are going to serve the Lord. He made a decision as to what he was going to do. And that's what we as a people need to do. We need to make that decision as to, are we going to serve God or are we going to serve the idols that we have within our own lives? What are we going to do there? In Exodus 24:7, a few chapters back, which we talked about a few weeks ago, Moses came down from the mountain, if you remember, with the Ten Commandments, and the Lord said, tell the people this is how you are supposed to live. Right? And Jeff spoke on this about all the laws that there were. He gave the Ten Commandments and there was laws off of this. This is how it's supposed to be. And what did the people say? Whatever you said that the Lord said for us to do. We will be obedient. 24 verse 7. We're going to be obedient to whatever the Lord God says. A little more than a month later, Aaron, throw the gold, make us a god. What happened? Prone to wander. That's what happened. They took their own desire and they made a decision to say, I said that I was going to serve God. I said that we were going to obey him. But you know what? Time's ticking. I'm not getting what I want. I'm going to make it myself. I'm going to make my own God. They changed their mind. They got the ready mix out, right? It was too difficult for them. They didn't want to put the time and effort in. They didn't want to wait upon the Lord. So they got their own ready mix out to make the own God that's going to fit their desire. Idols within this world, they consume us and they hijack the place of God in the hearts of his creation. Hijacks his place. God's place within our lives is right there in the center. When you look at the painting of our lives, like I just said in the beginning, it should have been the Lord number one. That should have been a main focus. That should have been done. But everything else that we have going within our lives, it hijacks that place that God's supposed to have, and it puts him aside, and we are consumed with that of which we want. We are consumed with our desires, and that becomes the idol. And instead of saying, okay, Lord, I know I'm supposed to serve you. I know I'm supposed to be in obedience to you. Instead, I'm going to turn to my own way. And that's what he says in verse 7 and 8 of 32. And the Lord said to Moses, go, get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves and have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf and worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. How big of a slap in the face to God do you think that was? I heard your cry, Israel. You were in bondage for 400 years. I heard your cry, and I have come, and I have taken you out of slavery. I have brought you safely through the land, crossed the Red Sea. I have provided for your needs. I have provided for your desires. And now they say, forget it. I'm doing my own thing. And they hold up this idol, this molded, man-made image, and said, this is your God that has brought you out of the land of Egypt. Slap in the face to a holy, righteous God. And they said, we don't want you. We want our own. And we, as a people, tend to fall into that same category many times. We don't think of it in that way. But how many times do we hold our idols up that we have and say, God, this is what I'm serving? And what are idols that we have within this world? You know, I've asked different people just as kind of a survey going throughout the week, what's an idol that we have within our lives? And it's mostly pretty much the same answers that they'll give. Money, right, is a big one. Time is an idol. You know, status is an idol. And they give pretty much the same type of answers. And I said to the one guy, I said, well, what about, I said, that's all kind of physical stuff that you can go after a lot of it, or something that you're putting forth. But I said, what about emotions? I said, is happiness an idol? Look at Solomon in Ecclesiastes. What did he go after? Happiness. He tried everything but the Lord to fill that desire within his heart. And he said, vanity of vanities, what's it all worth? Is what he finally came to the end. Because that's what he was trying to worship. He was making happiness his idol, going after everything he possibly could. Wealth he had, women he had, success he had, status he had. Everything that could make this world happy, he had, and it was worthless. It became his idol. What about inadequacy? How many people worship inadequacy? What do you mean about that? If it consumes you and it stops you from worshiping the true God, is it not an idol? And how many people today, myself included, inadequacy is something I fall deeply into. I say, what am I worth? Am I really worthy of doing that which I'm supposed to do? I'm not good enough. I'm not smart enough. I'm not strong enough. I'm not this. I'm not that. I am too inadequate, and it consumes our lives, and that is what we tend to worship. That is what fills that space in our heart, and what it does is going to stop us from serving God. Therefore, it becomes an idol within our lives. Because I can't serve in this area. I'm not good enough. We worship, tend to end up worshiping ourselves and worshiping the fact that we say we're not good enough. But what does God say? And we see that within the garden. Adam and Eve wasn't, they were too inadequate. They served themselves because they say, we're not made in the way that God made us. We want to be better than what God made us. We want to be God himself. And that's what the serpent said to them, and that's what they followed after. They were serving the idol of inadequacy, serving the idol of self at that point. And fear. How many people worship the idol of fear? That's a tough one, huh? How many people are consumed with fear? Fear of what's going to happen in the future. Fear of what's going to happen tomorrow. Fear of what God may do. Fear of what man may do. And we just live our lives constantly consumed by fear. It takes over. It stops our worship. It becomes an idol in our lives. We worship the God of fear. But God tells us that he did not give us a spirit of fear. That comes from Satan. He wants that idol to be in our lives, because if we are so consumed by fear, we are so consumed by self, we are so consumed with trying to fill our need of happiness, then there is no way we have time or effort to put into a relationship with God. It becomes the idol in our lives. And it's a decision that we have to make each and every day to wake up and say, I am not going to serve the God of fill in the blank, but I am going to serve the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, Yahweh, the God of all gods, the one and only God, of which there is no other. That's what we got to do each and every day when we wake up. We are a human people. We are frail. We are going to fall. We are weak. We don't want to think of ourselves that way, but that's how it is. And if we don't have the rock of our salvation, the rock that we can hold on to, the one that never changes, the one that doesn't change like the shifting sands of the sea, if we're not holding on to him in every day, we are going to fail. And we are going to be taken away by the tide of this world and the idols of this world. And that's what we're going to look at when all we had to do was reach out and grab onto the rock and say, you are the one that I want to serve. Is it going to be easy? No. God never said it was going to be easy, but he said, this is the way it needs to be. And so each and every day, we need to get up and say, God, you are the one I am going to serve today. And if we fall, then he says, confess your sins, and I am faithful and just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. Get back up and start walking towards me again. That's what we need to do. That's what God commands. And that is what is going to fulfill our lives and fulfill that desire that we have within us. Following God alone. Who is on the Lord's side? Verse 26, chapter 32. Then Moses stood in the entrance of the camp and said, whoever is on the Lord's side, come to me. And the sons of Levi gathered themselves together to him. So Moses comes down and he says, it's time to make a decision. Who is on the Lord's side? It's decision-making time. You had your desire out there. Now I am looking you in the eye and I am making this proclamation. Who is on the Lord's side? If it's you, then come here and stand by me. The sons of Levi came forward, and we'll get into that later, but the tribe of Levi ended up becoming the priestly tribe, all right, of which the priests that fulfilled the temple obligations and all that, the Lord made them. That we'll get into that later. But the sons of Levi come to him. And when you read on, continuing on to verse 26, verse 27. And he said to them, "Thus says the Lord God of Israel, let every man put his sword on his side and go in and out from the entrance to entrance throughout the camp, and let every man kill his brother, every man his companion, and every man his neighbor." And the sons of Levi did according to the word of Moses, and about 3,000 men of the people fell that day. Now, when you're looking back at that, the people that were killed more than likely were the people that were continuing on in this idol worship, and the Lord says, we got to get rid of them. And when you're looking back at the verses I read, verse 6, when it says that they sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play, all right, they weren't rising up to kick a soccer ball around. They weren't rising up to throw a football around, you know, to play a game of cornhole. All right. When it talks about getting up to play, it was an idolatrous worship. It was a sexual. It was orgies. It was all kinds of corruptible, damnationable acts that they were doing. And the Lord says, we cannot have this. And those that are going to continue on, we are going to wipe out. And about 3,000 people died that day, were killed by the sons of Levi. The Lord is standing here and he is saying, do not mess with me. I am serious about this. Sin is serious. And how often do we as a people just go by and just, oh, I sinned. Ah, doggone it. Did it again. How seriously do we take sin in our lives? We don't have the slightest comprehension about the seriousness of sin. Serious enough for God to send his son to be crucified on this earth, to shed his blood, to be ripped apart, his beard torn out, thorns placed on his head, to be whipped to the point to where the internal organs could be seen, to the point where he was hanging on that cross is basically a piece of meat that you could not even recognize that he was a human being up there. God takes sin pretty seriously. And he is saying to the people, I'm not joking around, and the 3,000 graves that you are going to see out here, let that be ingrained into your mind. And remember, next time you go to do something against what I said, allow those 3,000 graves to burn back and say, God isn't messing around. Who is on the Lord's side? Choose you this day. Make a decision. Who are you going to serve? And finally, the direction of our lives. We have the desire of our heart. We've made a decision, and that decision is going to dictate the direction that we take within our lives. Our choices are going to guide our path. Are we going to go with the emptiness of this world, or are we going to go with the fulfillment of God? Are we going to take our lives in the direction of worshiping the golden calf, or are we going to take our lives to the tabernacle and worship the true God in the way that we are supposed to worship him? What is our direction going to be? How are we going to go? Turn over, if you would, to Exodus chapter 40. Exodus chapter 40. I'm going to read verses 34 to 38. You see, God's glory was present when worship was done correctly. When the tabernacle was there and the people knew that the way to worship, that's when his presence filled the tabernacle and came down to them. Verse 34, then the cloud covered the tabernacle of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. And Moses was not able to enter the tabernacle of meeting because the clouds rested above it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Whenever the cloud was taken up from above the tabernacle, the children of Israel would go onward with their journey. But if the cloud was not taken up, they did not journey till the day that it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was above the tabernacle day by day, and the fire was over it by night in the sight of all the house of Israel throughout all their journeys. God was pleased with the final product. When they came to worship the way that they were supposed to worship, God was there among them. You see, the cloud that was up in Mount Sinai, the cloud that was over Mount Sinai that Moses would go up to, that the people couldn't even go towards, they couldn't go towards the mountain, they couldn't touch the mountain, they couldn't get near the mountain, because if they did, they would die. That cloud, God's presence that was there that Moses could see, came down now to the people. It wasn't far from them. It wasn't something that they weren't able to reach. It wasn't something that they weren't able to come in contact with. But the presence of God, when worship was done correctly, came down from above and covered the tabernacle. And the presence of the Lord was among the people there. When the worship was right, when the worship was true, when the hearts were where they were supposed to be in the Lord, that's where God's presence was. And the presence was so strong, the glory so great from the God that we serve, that not even Moses could enter in. Moses had talked to God face to face. God had come down to Moses in the tent that they had before that Moses would set up. And it says that he talked to him like a friend. Moses would go up to Mount Sinai into the cloud. He had the writing of God in his hand, in the tablets that he had. At that point, he was able to commune with God. He was able to be with God. He was there in his presence. Yet the glory of God was so great at this time as he came down, because the worship was the way it was supposed to be, that Moses could not even enter the tabernacle. That's the glory that we want in our lives, is it not? That's the glory that we should want in our lives. That's the glory that we should want to consume us. We should want to see that glory. We should want to have that, to go after it. That's what should fulfill our lives. That's what should fill that void that we have. That eternity that is within our hearts, that's what we should be going after. God, let me see your glory, like Moses said. And the Lord allowed him to see part of his glory as he put him up in the cleft of the rock and allowed his glory to pass by. And Moses was able to see the back side of him, see the trail of his glory, the tail end of it, to where even seeing that, his face shone. Do you not, as a people, want your face to shine because of how much of the glory you've got of God? We should want that. We should desire that. That should be our focus. Forget about the idols of this world. Forget about everything that you can strive for that is going to leave you empty. We got to search after the glory of God. It's a relationship that we have to work on. It's a relationship that is not easy. It's a relationship that is going to take time and is going to take effort. But man, the end goal, the end prize, what we get from it is more than we can even imagine. The glory of God fill your life. We need to take those idols that we have within our lives, and we need to enter the tabernacle. And we first come to that brazen altar, and we need to take the idols of our lives, and we need to put it on that altar, and we need to sacrifice them to God and say, God, I am done with them. We need to burn them up and let them go. Burn the idols on the altar. And then we come to the basin that is next, and we wash ourselves and cleanse ourselves and say, Lord, I am sorry for my sins. I confess my sins. And we wash ourselves clean within the basin that he has there. And within that, in that cleanliness, then we enter into the holy place. And when we enter into that holy place, we have the lamp that is the light of the world, that is God himself, and we can see the glory of God there as the light shines. We feast on the table of showbread, on the word of God. We take him as he is. He is the bread of life, and we can feast on that. And we have that within us. And then we go to the altar of incense that stands there, and we offer up our praise to God. The sweet smell that raises to God, the praises that we give him, the honor that we give him, the glory that we give him, that say, God, you are the one that has sustained me to this point, and you are the one who fulfills my life. I am going to put this here on the altar of incense, and I am going to send up my praise. I'm going to send up my worship. I'm going to send up everything that I have, because you are the one due to it. Enter, and we look, and we have the curtain that divides the holy place from the holy of holies. Do not stand outside the holy of holies, as I said last time I spoke. Do not be consumed by the idols of this world and just stand outside the Holy of Holies and say, this is all I'm consumed by. God, by the blood of Jesus, has torn down that curtain. We need to enter into the Holy of Holies and we need to worship the Lord God Almighty. We need to be consumed by God. We need to be consumed by everything that He is. Be consumed by the love that He has for us. Be consumed by the passion that He has for us. Be consumed by everything that He is and allow that to cover our lives, not the idols that we can make up of ourselves. True worship. The true God. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my life. He needs to be the one we see over all. He needs to be the one that fulfills us. We have desires within our lives. We need to make the decision as to what we are going to serve. And we need to follow that direction in the path that we are going to choose. Let it be the path that leads to glory. Let it be the path that leads to salvation. And then when the Lord comes again, He will take us and receive us up to Himself, that where He is, there we may be also. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank You for this time that we had this morning. I thank You that You are the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I thank You that You are a loving and holy God. Lord, I thank You that You do not just wipe us out every time that we sin, Lord, for there would not be one person here today. This earth would be empty. We are a fallen people, Lord, but You are gracious, You are loving, You are kind, You are merciful, Lord. And You are not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance to You, Lord. All that should come to salvation. I just ask if there is anyone here, Lord, that has not been able to feel Your glory, Lord, that if there is someone here who has not had the glory of the Lord over them, covering them, Lord, that You would just bring them to Your saving knowledge today, Lord. Allow them to pray to You, asking You, simply saying, Lord, I am forgive me for the sins that I have committed, Lord. I know that I am a sinner. I know that You have come, that You have died for me, that You have offered this gift of salvation through the blood of Your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, and I accept it now with an open heart. Lord, fill my life. Make me complete with You, Lord. Allow me to be a child of Yours, and I thank You, Lord, for allowing me to accept this gift of salvation today. And Lord, for those that have accepted You as Lord and Savior, and that do not feel the presence of Your glory, Lord, may that cloud of Your glory come over them, Lord. May we get back to the true worship as to who You are, Lord. That we work on that relationship. That we seek You, Lord. For You say that if You seek me, You will find me when You search for me with all of Your heart. Lord, we thank You. With the only thanks that we can give, we can never repay for what You did for us, Lord. We can simply offer up our worship, offer up our sacrifices, and offer up our praise to a God who is worthy of all. Bless us this day, Lord. Bless us this week. And allow us to seek You every day and be filled with Your love. In Your name, amen.
Won't you stand as we sing?
Amen.
There's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Give me praise.
I just want to read this quote that I read last week from A.W. Tozer. It really resonated with me, so I'd just like to read it again. It says, with the veil removed by the rending of Jesus' flesh, with nothing on God's side to prevent us from entering, why do we tarry without? Why do we consent to abide all our days just outside the Holy of Holies and never enter at all to look upon God? Now, it's a strong saying from him. And just a announcement, looking at the way that the world is today, the way that the world's going, trying to get rid of the glory of God. There is a school board meeting tomorrow night at 6 o'clock at the middle school on Reeds Road. All right, so if you want a voice, you're involved, you have kids involved with that, or you just have that desire that says that the Lord needs to be represented in that place, then you can go to that meeting and let your voices be heard and let the glory of God shine in a dark world, in a dark place. All right, so that's tomorrow night at 6 o'clock. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, again, I thank you. Lord, we cannot thank you enough. But as we come to you and offer up our praise and our worship, Lord, may you be glorified through it. May it be a sweet smell to you, Lord. Bring us throughout this week, Lord. Let us to be a light in the darkness. Lord, allow us to feel your presence. Lord, allow us to be overwhelmed and consumed with who you are. And as we enter into a week, Lord, that is Valentine's Day, Lord, may we reflect on your love that you have for us, in that while we were yet sinners, you died for us, Lord. Lord, you are an awesome God, more awesome than words. But we love you, we praise you, and we thank you. And all God's people said, amen. Have a good week.